parents and Sunday school children to their class. I believe that God is going to answer some of your prayers and He's going to reveal some things for you tonight. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. As He moves in this place, let Him continue on to move in your heart. Allow His Spirit to quicken our mind so that we can receive with meekness His engrafted word. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen. If you love Pastor, say, we love you, Pastor.
I love you, Pastor.
Put your hands together and welcome the Pastor.
Took wives and he took concubines.
to, but I don't really know the reason, but possibly to spread the royal bloodline. What an excuse, yeah. This is the setting of our text tonight, and I want you to think in your mind that David is king. He's unwise, he's unconfident, he's one of the many possible. I'm not saying that he's a godly customer. It wasn't because he was going to be wise, but part of it was to expand the bloodline. And this is nothing new in some traditional cultures. And it is at this junction that we read 2 Samuel chapter 5 and verses 13. And David took him more concubines and wives out of Jerusalem after he was come from Hebron. And there were yet sons and daughters born to David. And these be the names of those that were born unto him in Jerusalem: Shamuah, and Shobab, and Nathan, and Solomon. Some of those names you might be a little familiar with, and probably most of them we're not too familiar with. Imhar also, and Elishua, and Nepheg, and Japhiah, and Elishama, and Eliada, and Eliphelet. So I'd like to preach on verse number 16. Let me read it again. And Elishama, and Eliada, and Eliphelet. And I like the title of this, David's Three Children. Look at your neighbor and say, David's Three Children. Thank you, Lord, for your word. We ask you, Lord, to anoint the ministry of your word, release the gift of faith. Give us great understanding in this house, Lord, for where your spirit is, anything is possible to them that believe. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Let there be a spirit of revelation and conviction ministering this house to individuals. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Everybody say amen. You may be seated tonight. Thank you for standing so well. David had many children by his half a dozen or so wives. And of the three children that were born in Jerusalem, we find tonight that three were mentioned in this 16th verse. And these three names are very interesting. And these three names arrest my attention tonight. You know, there are many things surrounding how people name their children. There are many things surrounding how children in the Bible were named. Oftentimes, there were circumstances that came about, and some named their children because of circumstances, but others named their children in spite of circumstances to kind of get them to not become victim to the circumstance. Amen?
Amen.
But these three names are interesting today, and they're forgotten names. They are not mentioned outside of this particular passage. And many of us, if we were given a Bible quiz, would not really be sure if this was names on Who Wants to Be a Millionaire. We'd probably phone a friend, and then you would call me and say, Pastor, is Elishama, Eliada, Eliphelet named? And I would say, I don't know. Then you would say, give me 50-50. Then two would go down, right?
Yeah.
would say? I don't know either. So these names are hardly recognizable, hardly even mentioned. And I'm a third child, and I have three children. So three children are a good number of children to have. Amen?
Amen.
David had many well-known sons. I'm going to venture out and say, Sister Kathy, that his most famous son was Solomon, renamed Jedediah by the prophet Nathan. Solomon, the son of David, was known for his heavenly wisdom. And Solomon, we know, succeeded David as king of Israel as time moved on. Another son of David that was pretty well known was Adonijah, one that was born in Hebron. When we look at Adonijah with Joab's help, we find that they tried to manipulate themselves to become the king. Bathsheba influenced that. Nathan influenced that. Zadok influenced that. Benaiah influenced that. And all of them tried to get David's son Adonijah to be the king, but it didn't work. Well, we know some of his other sons. What about Abner? What about Absalom? He was the vengeful one who slew his half-brother and stole everybody's attention from his father in Israel. These are sons of David that we are accustomed to hearing. I don't know if I would say they're famous or infamous, and it depends on your perspective. Some people today, I'm amazed by some of the names that people name their children. The Rock, after The Rock. What's that Matrix guy? Keanu Reeves. You don't know how many Keanu's came out on the scene. I guarantee you, if you look at the birth records, how many Moanas came out on the scene, maybe? You might have a few of them. Some parents today name their children after heroes, after sports figures, after stars, I guess. But in biblical times, we find that the naming of children was really a spiritual event. It was a very significant event. I'm blown away by some of the names of some of my students today. They get fancy, us as a Catholic, with the names. They try to fancify the name that mean nothing. My favorite is Absidy, because it's A, B, C, D, E. And their mother's name is Loretta, their son, the mother's name is Loretta, the father's name is John, so their name is Lord John. You'd be surprised at their names. Sister Diana was working at Kaiser Hospital at one time, and she was in charge of doing the birth certificates for the name and doing all the registry. She said, Brother Mascalzo, one day there was a name that blew my mind, and somebody actually named their child Lucifer.
Wow.
In Bible times, he likes the family. He's a family. In Bible times, I'm getting someplace today. In Bible times, the naming of children was a spiritual event. I know the naming of our children took a process of time. One of them took a couple of months. Another one took 9 months until she came out, and we still didn't have a name. And they all live up to the name, to the T. Some of the names was a reminder for these parents of an experience that they had with God. And they wanted to remember the experience that they had with God, so they named their children that as a memorial and as a memory for them.
Right.
I think of Leah tonight, Jacob's, we're going to call lesser loved wife. She gave Jacob 6 sons. But the birth of her first 4 sons is interesting in the scripture. We find that the 4 sons are mentioned in Genesis chapter 29, verse 32, 33, 34, and 35. And all of their births, the statement says, when the Lord saw that Leah was hated, he opened her womb. Every one of those preceded those 4 boys. It was circumstantial. When the Lord saw that Leah was hated, he opened her womb. You can almost hear the voice of Leah coming out from her tent when each son was born. Because each son that was born to Leah was an answered prayer to Leah. But they were also a yearning inside of her heart to be loved. When her firstborn was born, she whispered, Reuben, because God has delivered me. When her second son was born, she whispered, Simeon, because God has heard me. And then when her third son was born, she calls him Levi, because God has united me. And finally, when her 4th son is born, she calls him, and she rejoices, she calls him Judah. God is to be praised. And the names of these boys in scripture were a reminder to Leah of God's faithfulness. That God has heard her, that God has delivered her, that God has seen her, that God has given her a reason to rejoice and to praise. I think when we look at the Bible is a beautiful book. Some people look at it as a textbook, they look at it historically. I guess you know how it was as a Aquinas when you were studying religion at the University of Hawaii. They have a very interesting perspective of the Bible. They look at it as a historical document. They look at it as poetry. They look at it as folklore. They look at it as theology. They look at it as legends. On the surface, the Bible as that is a very beautiful book to read. But the best things in the Word of God lies beneath the surface. It's not on the surface. If you search out the Bible diligently, the scripture says study to show thyself approved unto God. The scripture says that in this book is life. And if you dig out things in this book diligently, and you allow the Spirit of God to illuminate your understanding, Corinthians tells us, for the Spirit searches the deep things of God. There are things in this book that is beyond the surface that you might have read over it for so many times, but in the right moment and time, that one verse is something that God pulls out, is just what you need. Is a word rightly spoken in the right time. At times we are faced with the same predicament as the Samaritan woman. There are times when the well in front of us is so deep that we have nothing from which to draw from the well. It seems like the things are so deep, the scripture is so deep. But God, I believe tonight and beyond tonight, wants us to read beyond the surface words and dig a little deeper and allow His Spirit to illuminate the deep things of God that is in the well for us tonight. Sometimes it seems impossible because the well just seems so deep. But His Spirit can lead us to a place of understanding. The Samaritan woman, Sister Buena, said, the well is deep, and I have nothing to draw with. I gotta tell you tonight, the scripture is deep. much deeper than I am. And in all of my searching of the scripture, I've not even really scratched the surface. Day by day, we learn so many things, Sister Annelle. But it's the Spirit of God that can draw things from the depth of the Word of God that can bring them to the surface of our understanding. And the scripture does say, for those who are who hunger and thirst after righteousness, they shall be filled. If you are hungry and if you are thirsty, there is something that God can bring from the depths of His Word to the surface and illuminate to us tonight. I'm talking about David's three sons. Elishama, Eliada, and Eliphelet. I want to just go beyond just reading 2 Samuel chapter 5 and verse 16 on the surface. But I want us to go a little deeper and allow God to illuminate that particularly inspired verse in the Bible. We don't need to dig too deep before we see that these three unknown sons of David were spiritually significant in David's life. David, as we read about the life of David, he had some great experiences with God. He was a man after God's own heart, and we've used him in many scriptural, in many sermons, in many Bible stories. He's spoken about greatly in the Psalms. But there were three lessons tonight that David had learned that he chose to place in the name of these three sons that I want to speak about tonight. When we look at these three sons there, it's pretty pitiful when we think about it that there's not much written about them. There is no record of these three sons winning any battles. Neither is there any record of them losing any battles. There is no record of these three sons if they were loved by people or if they were hated by people. Their biographies, if I could say, is pretty short. Six-word biography. And Elishama, and Eliada, and Eliphelet. It doesn't talk about great deeds that they did, or great heroes that they were. But yet, if we dig deep, there are three lessons that I want to share with you tonight. That David chose. It might almost seem like there was no battle to remember them by, no great event to remember them by, no way that people treated to remember them by, Brother Tom. It almost seems like the Holy Ghost, when he inspired the writer to write this particular verse, that it was never his intention for these boys to be remembered by their great feats and their great acts. But it was the intention of the Holy Ghost for these three boys to only be remembered by their names. Elishama, Eliada, Eliphelet. Some of these names, I wonder, how do these people get these names? Like, I'm looking at it like, who would name their kid Ibar? Jaziel. Like, when you look at them, you smile, the name of Barry. I would have named him Michael. But what causes David to say, I'm going to name him Elisha? I believe tonight that when David named each of these sons, he will remember and event for a time that God had brought him through. And I want to tell you tonight that every one of us should have an Elisha in our life, an Eliada in our life, and an Eliphelet in our life. Everybody say Elishama. 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 You know what Eli means, right? Elishama means God hears. And when David named him Elishama, David knew exactly what he was doing. God hears. I shall name this boy Elishama. God hears. Elishama. God hears. It seems like this single truth is something that's been obviously repeated in David's life. God hears. David knew that God hears as well as any other person alive. If we look at the life of David, he would stand before you as a witness, and he would put his hand on the word of God, and he would pledge the oath that he would not lie. He would say, God hears. Experience after experience in David's life, he knew God hears. David's faith was simple. The righteous cry, he wrote in Psalms. Chapter 34, verse 17, he wrote, the righteous cry, and the Lord heareth, and delivereth them out of all their troubles. It seems when David named Elishama, he had an experience, or he could attest to, and he was a witness, Brother Tom, that God hears. He penned it in the Psalms that when the righteous cry, the Lord hears. I want you to know tonight, Pentecostals of Y&I, that there is a God that we don't just sing about tonight, but a God that hears. He has ears that he can hear. The Bible says his ears are inclined unto the cries of his children. You might think that sometimes when you pray, he doesn't hear you. You might not feel that he hears you. But I want to stand before you tonight and say, we must have an Elishama in our lives to remind us every single day, Sister Adele, that God hears. God hears. God hears. It doesn't matter if you didn't respond from the top, but God hears the righteous cry, and the Lord heareth them and delivereth them out of all of their troubles. David was so confident, Sister Kanani, that God would hear him when he cried, that he said, when the righteous cry, God heareth them.
Hallelujah.
What a God.
What a God. Yes.
So, yes. Righteousness.
That's right.
Man, we have all sinned and fall short of the glory of God.
Right.
Brother Archie, you said it well in your pre-service prayer today. God, forgive me. My wife spoke about it a couple weeks ago when she went to prayer. All she could say was, God, I'm sorry. For a couple hours, all she could say was, God, I'm sorry. God, I'm sorry. We all sin and come short of the glory of God.
Yes.
But there's something about true, genuine repentance when we come back to God, that we can be righteous in His sight, Sister Naomi, and we can cry unto Him, and the Lord hears. Elishama. He wanted to be reminded. Elishama. He was confident that God would hear him. That's the kind of faith you and I need. Very simple faith. Confident that when I pray, when I cry, God hears me. I might feel like I'm walking this valley alone, but David said, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, thou art with me. He wasn't afraid of the valley because he knew his God was an Elishama. He knew his God heard him.
Hallelujah.
James would say, yes, David. The Apostle James would agree with David tonight. He would say, yes, David, I agree. We have not because we ask not. That's what James said. Because James had an Elishama too. James knew that we have not because we ask not. James knew if I just ask God, he hears me.
Amen.
If John was standing before us today, he would say, yes, sir, David. I agree, David, that the Lord heareth. He said, since God hears us, ask in confidence, he said in 1 John. That's what John said. John had simple faith. John must have had an Elishama in his life too. John said, God hears. that I should love. But he wanted us to remember tonight to support that I hear, I hear you, 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 I hear you. Jesus said, ask what ye shall, or ask what you will, and it shall be done. There was a correlation between asking and hearing. David knew this. I don't know if it was his motto or his mantra or what. I don't know if he got a banner from Kiko that put it in the front of his tent. I don't know what he did. I don't know if he made business cards that said Elisha up, and everywhere he went, he passed them out. I don't know. But I know for what a fact of one thing, that he must have understood that simple faith that God hears. He understood it and believed it so much, Sister Shauna, that he was willing to name one of his sons Elisha. God hears. When you name your child, when you name your boy, Isaiah, when you name him, come here, Aloha. You don't do that because you don't have names. You do that for a reason. You do that because his namesake is valuable to you. His namesake, when you name your child after a parent or a grandparent, you do that because it's valuable, because you honor them, you love them, or you might name them after an experience. When David named that child, he didn't just run out a name that was the next on the baby book of names in that name. There was a reason. He said, I will name this child Elisha. It will be a remembrance to me from this day on, when I sit across him at the table, when I watch him playing at the park, when it seems like things are not going well, and when I have to call him and say, Elisha, come in the house and eat. It'll be a reminder to me that God hears when the righteous cry. God will hear our cry. Elisha. We need an Elisha in our lives. We need to be reminded that God hears. I don't know, maybe Elisha was just posted on the refrigerator. I don't know. But I can almost hear David speaking, and David saying, son, you don't have to be as smart as Solomon, because Solomon is smart. Solomon was endowed with wisdom, son. You don't have to be as smart as Solomon. You don't have to be as handsome as Absalom, son. You're just here to remind me that God hears. Your son, every day, you don't know what you do for me, son. You might not have wisdom, you might not be the most good looking of all my kids, but son, every day, you're a reminder to me, Elisha. God hears. We have those memorials in our lives. You know, when some of us have children and we recognize this is a gift from God and a blessing from God that cannot run off after the first month we have our child. It has to be a gift from God when they're 16, when they're 17, when they're 18, when they're borrowing money from you, when they're 25, when they're giving you strength, when they're 35. They got to still be a reminder to you that they were a gift from God. You know how many people, Sister Puerta, named their child, what do you call that? Makala Maike Apua. What's your daughter's name, Logan? Makala what?
Makala Aloha.
Makala Makala Aloha. That, she named them that because that baby was a gift to her. But that baby's going to be a gift more than in the hospital room. That baby, every day of your life, when you call that baby Anela Makamai, yeah? I don't know why. I never gave my love for my name. Anela Makala Makamai. Okay, what? I got it now. Every day when you say Anela Makala Makamai or Aloha. Every day, that baby's going to remind you when she's pulling your hair and yelling at you, and when you're stressed out and you're taking it out on the poor baby. It's going to be a reminder to you that was a precious blessing, a precious gift from God. And every day, that's going to be an Elisha mom. That's going to be the one every day, David. And you he hears what he wants to hear. Isaiah said our wickedness can keep God from hearing. James said our worldliness can keep God from limit God's hearing. Genesis says our willfulness can keep God from hearing. Don't stop, but God hears and he wants to hear you. He wants to hear your voice. We talk about prayerlessness, but faithlessness is worse. We must have confidence that God hears us when we pray. I don't care if it's an hour prayer, it's a 5-minute prayer, but out the door. Confidence that God hears us when we pray. When you walk out that door, you didn't have that much time for the day, you just said, God protect me. You do not even see what happened in the spiritual realm. You might say, not really, not really. I gotta tell you something. I don't dare leave my house or even leave my parking lot without asking God to protect me. I gotta be honest with you. I'm very hesitant about driving my car with my children without asking God to dispatch an angel or without asking God to cover us with his blood or protect us. I just believe that God hears for the top. I cannot afford some driver to be reckless or on their cell phone or careless to wipe my whole family out. And every single day, I've got to ask God that I know and I have confidence in him that God hears. There is an Elishama, 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 Elishama. What a name, Elishama. We don't pray and we believe our God is deaf. The early church prayed and the world was turned upside down because they believed that God heard them. The prophet prayed and fire fell because God heard him. The psalmist of Israel prayed. Paul and David prayed. Giants came down. Strongholds came down. Things disappeared. Estrangement, all kinds of stuff began to happen. All kinds of things changed because David understood that he served a God who heard him. If your heart is torn apart, I want to tell you, you can mend it with Elishama because God hears. If you've got wounds, they can be healed through Elishama because God hears. If your relationships are fragmented, they can be reconciled. How? Elishama, God hears. That was President David's mantra, man. Whatever the problem was, Brother Tom, what? You got a relationship problem? Elishama. Elishama, God hears. What? You got financial struggle? Elishama, God hears. What? What do you mean, widow? Widow, you mean you don't have nothing and the creditor is coming? Elishama, God hears. What? You're in the presence of the enemy? Elishama, God hears. What? The king is coming after you? God, Elishama, God hears. Yeah. You might think your trial is too long, and how do you endure it? I tell you how to endure it. Elishama, God hears. You might feel your children are going in another direction, but how? Elishama, God hears. Silence doesn't work in God's word. Call on him because he hears. But David had more experience in that because he had another son. This one he called Eliathan. And Eliathan means God knows. For some reason, David needed another son. And he knew God hears. But this one, he said, I should name you Eliathan. God knows. What confidence it is to know that God hears. But what greater confidence it is to know that God knew all of it before we prayed. That God knows. We never catch God by surprise, people. We never come to him in prayer and say, surprise! Even if we're Chinese. David had this thing about him, Sister Puella. That David had this sense inside of him that God knew everything about him. David knew child, David knew God was there. As a child, he felt the hand of God upon him. David sensed it. And as he was watching the sheep, God was watching David. Because God knew, yes, Lord, you are my shepherd, he said. He said, the Lord is my shepherd. God, David knew, as he was a shepherd to others, God was a shepherd to him. David knew that God knew him. To David, God wasn't some distant thing in the universe way out there in outer space. He was a God who knew him. David had a God who knew him. Sister Elizabeth, we serve a God who knows you. And the bear seemed small to David because he had a God that saw them. The lion was small to David because he had a God that knew him. The giant was small to David because David had a God who was his shepherd and who knew him. It's something to be able to walk and live your life and know that no weapon that is formed against thee shall prosper. We can quote all kind of stuff, but if you really understand that you have a God who knows, Brother Archie, He knows the stuff you did this week before you uttered it out of your mouth. He knows the stuff you thought before you even confessed that you thought that. He knew the things you thought that you couldn't even believe you thought. He knew the things that you whispered out of your lips that nobody else heard, but God knows all of that. He knows. He knows. Eliyahu, I shall name the second dog, second son of God, second son, Eliyahu. God knows our time frame. God knows our deeds. He knows our misdeeds too. He knows our daydreams, and he knows our daydreams. Because God knows. When you name that son, he must have knew that God knew everything about it just well. In a way, that's not scary to me. That's a comfort that God knows. God knows the things that hurt me. God knows the things that I struggle with. God knows when I lift my hand in the house of God, how I wasn't all that I should have been that week. But here I am again, God. God knows. God knows my shortcomings before I utter them out of my mouth. But what a good God, he still blesses me anyway. He still lets me bask in his presence. God knows. God knows the feelings that you feel inside of you that you have a hard time controlling. He knows. The only thing we have about these three boys is we know they were born in Jerusalem. So we know because they were born in Jerusalem, they were born during the reign of King David. And this is interesting to me. Because during King David's reign, he was going to need an Eliyahu. During some time in his reign, he was going to need to be reminded that David, God knows. David, when you mess with Bathsheba, God knows. Hide it as much as you want, God knows. David, when you're afraid to make the move, God knows. David, when you got a big decision to make, God knows. It seemed like David tried to cover up his sin with Bathsheba. Bathsheba's husband had been killed, Uriah. A quick marriage was arranged. The child was about to be born. David must have congratulated himself how good of a job he did. He laid with Bathsheba. He tried to make her all of this stuff. He covered all up. Everything was going fine. He married the woman. The husband is dead. The child was about to be born. I don't know if David in that instant was feeling like, okay, I can cover this up. He was feeling like he could cover it. That's why he had the man killed. That's why he had a good marriage. Why not add another one on the list? I have a feeling with Archie that he figured he was smart.
Mighty.
Time you looked at that boy. Elisha, come inside. Eliada, come inside. It's like you're saying, God moves, come inside. Dealing with this guilt inside of him, and he has to call a boy. God moves. God moves. He wasn't that smart. He wasn't smarter than God. We know David's action was not very pleasing to the Lord. David, if you want to keep Elisha in your life, if you want God to keep hearing, if you want God to keep answering prayer, then you better keep that Eliada close to you too. Because God not only hears, he knows. Here's a lesson for all of you. We might want to give birth to an Elisha in our lives. We might want to have a reminder every day that God hears. That's our magic, that God hears us every time we pray. But if you want God to hear you, if you want an Elisha, well, you need an Elijah too. You need a reminder that God knows.
Amen.
That God knows everything, Sister Elizabeth. God knows everything, Precious. God knows everything, Pastor. God knows everything, Sapo. God knows. I want him to hear me and answer, but I also come with Elisha isn't Elijah God. They come in here. God knows. We need these children in our lives. Remember David was judging other men's sins. He was judging them to the point, Sister Kathy, that he was blind to his own. He was so blind that he was judging everybody else, that he was so blind for his own shortcomings. Be careful. I remember somebody said, be careful when you point your finger at somebody. I never did point like this. Point like that. Look at my thumb right now. Point one finger, people got it. I cannot tell you how many times I've gone to prayer, a little frustrated. And as soon as I come out, I'm frustrated with a finger halfway into the mouth. Look at the popcorn, the kettle now. I mean, God won't come back, but I mean, you just say, look at yourself before you start. Pull out your own beans out of your own eyes. David was judging everybody else, but he was so blind that he couldn't see his own sin. You heard the story. You know what God did with David because David couldn't see his own sin, Brother Jarvis? God sent the preacher. And God still does that today. Don't get mad at the preacher if you preach something, and sometimes they don't see it. It was Nathan. Nathan, the Makana Okiyafu. It was Nathan, the child of gift from God. It was Nathan who came to David. God loved David enough that God gave David a face-to-face encounter. He told him about the parable, you know the story. And the preacher said, you're the guy. You don't want to do that. You know, David understood Eliada, nothing is a secret from God. You cannot hide your record from him. And your hairs on your head is numbered. Now that's a little crazy. Not how many you have, he says, your number. He knows how many you have, and he knows that this one right here, this one's right here, number 5,872. This one is 6,374. He got the number, Brother Tom. Not that, I mean, he knows so much about you. God knows. David named one of the sons of Bathsheba after the preacher. And he named another son, Eliada. See what he's trying to get that God knows. It does good to remind yourself that God knows. When he sat at breakfast across the table, he was reminding you that God knows.
sat at lunch with his boy, it was a reminder to him.
When he sat at dinner with that boy, it was a reminder to him. God knows. I walked through the valley of the shadow of death. David wasn't afraid of that because God was with him.
I am the God knows. God knows when it's around the corner. It's not that God knows your sin, but God knows what's around the corner with a power.
God knows what he's shaping you for, where he's taking you to. God knows what he's doing. When it seems like there's a table prepared before me in the presence of an enemy, when it seems like everything piling up on me, God knows. God knows what's going on. He didn't turn off the lights and disappear. He knows. When you feel like you're the only person in the world and nobody else can help you, God knows. Just that now, God knows. He wants to remind us that he knows. You might, the Bible said there's nothing new under the sun. He knows. When you feel alone, he knows. When you feel like you tried your best and you keep messing up, he knows. When you feel like, man, it just seems like you get over one hurdle and then another one comes, he knows. When it seems like you just got to rain, but the taxes have been bombing you this year, he knows. When it seems like, yes, you're pushing hard and working hard and doing what you gotta do, you're eating yellow sausage and spam. And spam is expensive. He knows. God knows. You know how many times as a young adult I laid on my bed and looked at the ceiling and listened to God, when, what, and asked all these questions, and I wish I just had that revelation, that simple revelation, Brother Carl, that God knows. It doesn't seem so profound to many of you, but it's very profound when you think about it, that God knows. In spite of all of our circumstances over the last couple of days, God knows. God knows what he's doing. We still have an obligation to praise him. God knows what he did last month. He knows, he knows, he knows, he knows, he knows. I cannot blame God, curse God. God knows everything. He knows.
He truly does know.
Eliada. God, I want you to know me. I want you to know my ways. God, search my heart if there's any wicked thing inside of me. Know me, God. Don't forsake me, but just know me. Sing that song, cast me not away from your presence. Go. A body of a crooked song. We fall down, but we get up. We fall down, we get up. Who knows? For a saint to just a sinner. Who what? He knows us all. He will do us well. To have an Eliada in our lives to remind us every single day that he knows. When you think that's the roughest day of your life, he knows. When you think that this is the worst time that you've ever, this is the worst year of your life, he knows. When you feel so stressed out and trying to make ends meet, he knows.
Hallelujah.
You feel like you just get paid and more money without the coming in, he knows. We need a reminder, and Eliada, and Eliada, and Eliada, and Eliada. He knows. Donnie McCorkin wasn't just singing a song. There was a proverb, for a just man falleth 7 times and riseth up again. But the wicked shall fall into mischief. Get back up again. Get back up again. Get back up again. Righteousness doesn't mean you're perfect. Righteousness is a position with God. That you sit in a position with God because you're not perfect. He knows.
A righteous person isn't sinless. But a righteous person is like this. This just makes us righteous. We're always going this way, and this way, and this way. That there would be not a single one of us, every one of us would confess that. And every, you know, I figured I made more sin when I got into church. And it's not that I became more of a sinner, but I became aware of things. When I was in high school, cussing and playing around and tricking people and bombing tourists with AIDS, I didn't think anything was wrong with that. I thought it was all in fun in adolescence. But as you serve God, you begin to realize that that's not right. Righteousness is not perfection. It's disforgiving. If you can stay like this, you're going to hear your prayers. He's going to hear your prayers. Almost fell. David fell down. David slapped somebody that wasn't his. David murdered somebody that was innocent. David brought a child into this world, and he was guilty of bringing that child into this world, and he created the circumstances to make that child had a short-lived life too. I'm sure David messed up his trust with other people. David was a liar. David was a conniver. David fell down. You know what? He knew God knew where to sell. David. It didn't justify what he did. God was still this week, but he got back up. He got back up. And if David can get back up, then you can get back up. And when you get back up, don't forget Eliada. God knows. He knows you will fall. But he also wants you to know that he will help you get back up too. Everybody say Elisha. Eliada. Not bad for Hebrew one of our people. Not bad at all. Not bad. Elisha. Eliada. I guess you figure that Eli is God, huh? And his third child was Eli Follette. You know what Eli Follette means?
Oh, to feel the hand of God doing what he heard and what he seen.
Eli Follett. God delivers. David was compassed about with his enemies. Can you imagine when his enemies surrounded him, Sister Pua? Could you imagine Eli Follett stirring inside of him? God delivers. The reminder that the storm's not going to last forever. The reminder that this journey God is going to deliver. The reminder that He's going to bring you out. The reminder that the hand of the Lord can do anything.
Amen.
Jesus! The name of Jesus. You might seem asleep in the storm of your life on that boat. He might seem like he's not hearing the storm. He might seem like in the boat he's not seeing what's happening, the boat moving. He might seem like he's sleeping. But he's still. And in the midst of that storm in your life, we can watch Jesus position himself up off of that bed. In the midst of a raging storm, and we see him and we hear him in the Bible rebuke the wind and rebuke the rain, the waves, and deliverance in him. I told you tonight that God knows. I told you tonight that God hears. But I must remind you tonight that God delivers. God is more than eyes and ears. He's also fingers, hands, and toes. He can get the job done. You know what God knows? That knowledge that God has about you is for a purpose. You notice He doesn't use things to hurt you, but to heal you. What chains bind you today?
What mental prison is holding you hostage in your mind? God hears and God knows.
What needs to be broken off of your feet? God delivers, and He can deliver also. Somewhere in our lives, there must be a delightful in our life. We must have a delightful in our life. Might not be named delightful, it might go by another name, but somewhere in our family, there is an example of somebody who named delightful. And it's a reminder, God can do it for them, God can do it for me, God can do it for me. He is no respecter of persons. What He does for one, He'll do for you. Depression, be delightful in it. Sickness, be delightful in it. Addiction, be delightful in it. God delivers. Sorrow, be delightful in it. God delivers. Misery, God delivers. Pain, God delivers. He hears. He knows. He delivers. Every single one of us need these three children in our lives every single day to be a reminder to us every single day. He hears. He knows. And He delivers. That's why we can bless the Lord at all times. That's why our joy cometh from the Lord. That's why in His presence there is fullness of joy. That's why we don't have to live on a roller coaster ride, Brother Archie, depending how the day goes is how I'm going to worship Him. No, if you have in your life every day, God hears, God knows, and God delivers, I can truly, not just let there be lip service out of my mouth, but I can truly bless the Lord at all times. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be on my lips.
Hallelujah.
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 Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Three young boys. And I believe tonight, it wasn't their heroic deeds that God wanted us to be remembered about. It was just their names. Could you imagine for a moment if you would leave this house? Because of course, nothing strange happens to you when you leave the church, right? There's no arguments that happen. There's no narrow pipes that's broke. And there's no kids forgot to press the on button for the rice and you get irritated and the food is not ready tonight. None of that kind of stuff happens in the real world. None of us get irritated when we go to work and whatever, whatever, whatever. None of us are irritated when we got to call every 5 times. This is the real world. But if you would just remember, God hears, God knows.
Church that night.
putting on her knee brace, because her knee was really hurting her. She put on her knee brace, got herself ready, got in the car. And I was concerned because I knew her knee was bothering her, but how many steps did you get up on that church, Samuel? You think this is a lot of steps? Their church probably has 10 to 20 times more steps than this. And I was concerned about her walking up these stairs. But I watched her that night. Did you guys pray? That's why. You guys pray. God hears. Pray that she'll be out of the service. And she walks. And I watched her walk up those steps. It must have been about 20 steps. Anybody been to the Father's Church? That's a lot of steps. You know what? All those people walk up the steps, I'm not going to complain about the steps. We have too many complainers in Hawaii that don't want to walk up the steps. But all those old ladies, all those old men, if they got a photo to do it, they walk up the steps. I watched her walk up the step. On the first platform, she sat down on the bench. Got up, walked up the next steps. Reached that light. As soon as I opened up the call, oh, would you pray? Because Elisha, God hears. I watched my mother-in-law get up from the very maybe corners of the back pew, get up and humble like this in the front of that church. She grabbed the side of the front pew. And she got a small look. She went down on her knees like this. And then she went on her second knee like this to pray to me. And this thing had the tears started coming out of her eyes.
Elisha. God hears. And if that was the only reason for us to go, God knows this is how we pray. That in itself. Next service we went to in Apia, we gave the altar call, but she wasn't there. The first one up the altar. She wasn't like this great. She didn't pull up a seat to the front because she's an older woman. She said like this great. I wasn't satisfied with her. She got on her knees, both knees, and buried her face in the altar. Goodbye.